What's up, Internet? Welcome once again to the Free-to-Play Cast, brought to you by MMObomb.com, your home for all things free-to-play related. I'm your host, Mike Byrne, and this is episode 375. We're doing it live, February 5th, Friday, 1 p.m. over on our Twitch channel, twitch.tv/MMObomb. If you're watching this on MMObomb.com or on our YouTube channel, come on over and catch the live show. Take part in chat, get your weekly bombs, your question of the week answers read live, and have a lot of fun with us reacting to all the news. We've got a lot to get through today, so we're going to get right down to it after we introduce the co-host, Mr. Jason. What the?
Why, hello, Mike. How are you today?
What the hell is that?
What? Is there something on my face? What? What? No, I don't get what, you, what's wrong.
You've
here?
Got a little bit of rouge on, and it's.
Oh, yeah, you know. I went in the shower and I had like colored clothes washing with me, and I'm white, so you know, it just kind of all blended off.
Well, welcome, Mr. Jason Winter, doing like the Kilroy cat eyes. All we could see is the eyes. There we go.
He's actually pretty big.
Holy hell, that thing is huge.
Yeah, it is large. Like I thought it would fit up right in my chair, but no, it's like
it's heavily pixelating right now through Discord. But it is.
Yeah, well, it's so crazy. Yeah,
it is.
So, like,
it is. Your camera is like I have no idea.
It's breaking the stream. Yeah. Okay.
I have no idea what to do with this thing. Also on the line, Mr. Troy Blackburn. What's up, Noob Fridge?
I quit. I can't even do this anymore. Why?
Hey, I'm just happy that we are starting at 1 p.m. Eastern. That is very, very cool. The scheduled start time of the Free-to-Play Cast. We made it on time. Congratulations. Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to try to be a beacon of positivity today, but then Jason started with a giant plushy cat, so screw that. Let's go.
Well, we do have a lot to cover. Twitch acting up a little bit. Twitch, I'm sorry. Twitch live viewers, sorry for that. There's not really much I can do there. I see that.
Blame the cat.
Yeah, I see. This is the cat. I see my connection's excellent, but I do see a drop frame here or there. Hopefully, Twitch will stabilize shortly there. Sorry about that. What's up, C-Swag? Welcome. Let's head over and get started with the news. Well, normally we like to cover financials on this show when they come out, whether they be Nexon, NCSoft, or whatever. And we just had Blizzard's and Activision's financials last night. Not a lot in the free-to-play space. I'm sure, Jason, you know, you've already looked it over to see if there's anything we can cover there. And there is literally nothing besides an announcement of, yeah, they're going to get into more free-to-play mobile games. And we don't cover mobile games. So, I mean, unless they're cross-platform, we don't cover the mobile versions of, you know, you're not going to see Raid Legends on MMObomb anytime
Thank
soon.
God. Yeah. You see it everywhere else.
Yeah, you see it everywhere else. Speaking of that, this episode brought to you by Raid Legends. No, I'm just kidding. So yeah, not a lot there, but we do have some other financial news. Yeah, the music might have cracked a little bit there, Old Glory. I think I just went through that Twitch is a little bit choppy right now. Sorry about that, my friend. We do have financial news on the other side of things. Let's start with EA, of course. Apex Legends, again, just absolutely killing it, Jason. Just absolutely killing it.
Yeah, and I gotta say, I'm just surprised. Like, I knew it was doing pretty well, like, for the year and a half or so that it was on, you know, on Origin, only available there. Man, just looking at the Steam numbers lately and then seeing what they talk about in their financials about how much money it's bringing in. Like, it had, what was it? It set a new record, like, in the last, you know, 24 hours before I wrote this. Like, over 180,000 players. Yeah, 183,000 players. It was, like, the number 5 game on Steam or whatever. Just apparently from that last update that just came out a few days ago. Its previous peak was probably about 130,000, 140,000. And it just exploded past that, bringing in tons of money. Like, They couldn't be happier. It's mentioned all over the damn place, all throughout their thing. Like, oh, yeah. We had a great quarter thanks to Apex Legends.
Yeah,
we're gonna do well next year because of Apex Legends. Like,
yeah, I mean, if
it's
you want
the new tentpole flag franchise,
if you want the numbers, they reported net bookings of almost $1.7 billion. for the quarter, and almost just shy of $6 billion for the calendar year. Those are both up 5% and 8% for the same quarter and for a year, respectively. And they attributed that, of course, to live services outperforming, particularly in Ultimate Team and Apex Legends. And I gotta say, like, there's nothing I have against Apex Legends. Just because it's not my type of game doesn't mean I have, you know, ill wishes towards it or anything, Troy. But even I am surprised that with the way that fucking YOLO launched, right? it just threw itself out into the wild, into a crowded space with hundreds of other competitors, and not really anything, at least at launch. It's changed a little bit, and Jason alluded to Season 8 just launching this week as well, so that obviously every time a new season starts, you get a nice influx of players for a little while. It's just trucking right along. Is this your type of game, Troy, or do you, I know, attend to examine Battle Royales, but don't really stick with any. How do you feel about Apex?
Apex was a good game, and if you'll remember, the YOLO launch, while surprising, actually did kind of work for it in the beginning. Then it seemed to just kind of disappear after that. Like, it had a, like, it was all over Twitch and everywhere there for a few, for, I don't know, the first month or so. And then I felt like, and maybe that was just my perspective, it sort of disappeared into the nothingness again. And to come back and see this type of performance is actually a little bit shocking for somebody like me, who Apex isn't as in my face as I would have thought it would have been, as big as it is. It's a little surprising, and I'm happy for the game itself. I really hate to see them use the term such as live services is making our company way more profitable, because that's dangerous for the future of all gaming. But to see a game like Apex Legends, I'm glad that it's continuing to succeed.
They're expecting it, Jason, to run north of $500 million for the game throughout 2021. $500 million from a free-to-play game in a crowded game space. I mean, it's doing a ton of things right. Oh, by the way, not even available on the Switch yet. That's coming March 9th. Granted, you're probably not going to pick up hundreds of thousands of players, but you're going to add to your player base anytime you launch on a new platform. Oh, and there's a mobile game in the works for fiscal year 2022, which mostly happens for EA in most of 2021. So there's still growth potential for this game. They're forecasting $500 million this year.
Now, kind of going on what Troy was talking about, how he hopes doesn't build up expectations. You have to wonder, though, a little bit how much of that is, you know, pandemic money, which will be less maybe this year. But then again, if you're putting it on mobile devices, mobile and Switch, maybe it'll still stay there because you'll be able to take it with you when you're actually going out and interacting with people to some degree.
Yeah, it just keeps trucking along. I think that's the most surprising thing for me. Like, Troy, it YOLO launched and it was everywhere. But we also know that that was a heavy marketing blitz where high-profile streamers were getting ridiculous sums of money to stream the game for extended periods of time. And then, yeah, it essentially disappeared when those contracts were up, as far as, like, front-page Twitch. But it just keeps trucking, I think. Like, that is the most impressive part of this to me. I always expect big numbers, particularly when EA or Activision or any of the big, big companies drop something new right off the bat. But we're talking all this time later, still forecasted for $500 million. What wasn't mentioned anywhere in the financials, not even that they had the game anymore. I mean, you can go ahead and smirk all you want, Mr. Troy Blackburn. Star Wars The Old Republic, not even mentioned. Entirely absent. And this is two reports in a row running.
I don't know. I don't get it. Because you play the game, and it's the opposite of my Rift experience, where I walked into a main city, and there was like two other people there. And I literally mean two other people in the whole city. Swotor is packed. Every time I play, there's people everywhere. Every hub, every planet. Everywhere. Why this isn't getting reported in some way, I don't know. That's surprising. That's as surprising as Apex Legends is still as
profitable. I'll tell you why. It's not making money anymore. I mean, literally, it's not making big, noteworthy money anymore. When it made, what was it, Jason? $250 million back in the day when it went free to play and stuff and we were reporting on it. Boom. It was in the financial report. That's not to say that it's not making any money or anything like that.
The problem is it's not making that like headline money.
It's making half a billion dollars.
Yeah, it's making half a billion dollars over the course of the year. The other thing I think we should talk about here, though, Troy, again, you and I are SWTOR guys, you more so than I. I'm like every couple of months, I jump in for a month or two guy. You've been pretty steady at it lately. Jason doesn't care.
I was a SWTOR guy a long time ago.
Back in the day, you were a SWTOR guy.
A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
Zing. it's not exclusive to EA anymore. The license for Star Wars. So we already know of some other projects that other companies are working on. I would be stunned if there wasn't an MMO already being discussed, worked on, pitched out there somewhere. And I've said that on different streams before when asked about it. Now, whether it's BioWare or EA or some other company, I don't know. And I'm not even going to hazard a guess. And I don't think Old Republic's going to shut down anytime soon. But it is long in the tooth, and other people are able to take a crack at the Star Wars license now. So there is, I think, a little more pressure on getting something Star Wars related in the MMO space, whether that's amping up some stuff in SWTOR so that you discourage competition or somebody else coming in with some competition soon.
Well, here's the problem with that is the investment numbers that it took to create SWTOR in the first place are astronomical, and nobody's going to invest that type of money again. Yes, it is dated at this point. Yes, it does need updates at this point, but it was a huge, huge deal when it came out and when it was being developed. Now going forward, what you're probably going to end up with...
Estimates were around $200 million development costs for SWTOR.
Yeah, and then, so going forward, you're probably not going to see another true MMO of the Star Wars license. What you're probably going to get is some type of Avengers style live service game.
Oh, that's doing really well.
But that's what you're going to get because they're still convinced that that's the way to go. Look at the words in this article that we just wrote. Live services are blah, 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 blah. Yeah. Doing well, by the way. So that's what you're going to end up with. And for SWTOR itself, now, there again, it doesn't create headline numbers, but things like The Mandalorian, the single-player Star Wars games, those actually create increases in population in the game. Like I said, not headline stirring, but those traditionally have increased interest in Star Wars The Old Republic.
And they've got like 12 new series planned or whatever, so.
Yeah, just a few. Yeah. Just a few.
Just a few.
Just a few. We'll see. We'll see, but good on Apex Legends and Star Wars The Old Republic is still out there, regardless of what you may hear in EA's financial reports.
2 years ago, I never would have, if you'd have told me I'd have been on the show defending Star Wars The Old Republic, I'd have told you was out of your mind.
Yeah, just wait until we get you defending Bless.
Man, no.
To be fair, Anthem was also not talked about at all.
I legitimately forgot about that. Yeah. Completely. Yeah, right. I didn't even think to look for it.
Yeah. We have not heard anything on Anthem 2. Like, it has gone dark on that Anthem 2.0 project. And now Casey Hudson and other people have left again. So I don't know what's going on with that. Frankly, Jason, maybe I don't know how much of the stuff you read, but was BioWare mentioned at all? Like, I just thinking of like everything that they would have talked about. They didn't talk about SWTOR. They didn't talk about Anthem in any way, shape, or form. I'm sure Dragon Age was probably mentioned as upcoming.
Actually, didn't even mention Mass Effect, although that was kind of at its own announcement.
Yeah.
For the release date. Yeah,
the remasters.
No, I know it went dark to rework the game, but we were still hearing development concepts and stuff as far as Anthem 2 was going, and then it just went totally dark. And maybe that's just a development thing, or maybe some people have been reassigned to Dragon Age and other projects for now. We'll see. And Mass Effect 4. Yeah, Mass Effect 4 coming. Other financial news. Jagex, we reported, I think it was on last week's show or the week before. I don't remember which. But we reported about Jagex's new purchase, and Jason and I kind of scoffed a little bit at, were they actually purchased this time or not. And while Jagex wants you to know, Quote, we confirm that the Carlyle Group has acquired Jagex regardless of any claims made by third parties in relation to the deal. The allegations are meritless in all respects. Carlyle Group has not sent a response as of our reporting date on this stuff. Pluto-sama is still out there filing, Jason, saying, no, we own 55% of this damn place. This sale is not legit, nor was the last one. Oh, and they also allege, yeah, Jagex executives might be getting a little money to shut the hell up about it, which is why Jagex says all the allegations are meritless. Yeah.
Which, to be clear, anything we're going to talk about now are allegations Pluto-sama is making, not correct. That we are making.
Correct.
This is what they are saying in their statements. I got to take a drink. This is going to take a while.
Well, while Jason's drinking, I would like to announce that I now own 55% of Amazon. So,
sure you do. So, as you might remember, the last time Jagex was sold, sort of, a company called Platinum Fortune came along and did it under along partnered with something called the MacArthur Group, both of which were like things we'd never heard of. So they just kind of popped up out of basically nowhere.
Yeah. Platinum websites had, made with Wix type popped up out of nowhere. And that's, I'm not joking. Websites made with Wix still advertised on the bottom of the website. Like they didn't even take off the boilerplates.
And Jagex said at the time, yes, we have definitely been purchased by them. So, take whatever they're saying with a grain of salt. But apparently Platinum Fortune had been working with Pluto-sama. It was like a limited partnership that they had made up to purchase Jagex. That was like 2 years ago. So Pluto-sama got word, though, that the money that they were being used, that the Platinum Fortune guys had, was basically stolen from, I don't remember even, there was a lot in this lawsuit, but basically the money was stolen is what they came up with. So they ended their partnership. And then later on, when Platinum Fortune tried to buy Jagex, they said, no, you guys don't have that money, or it's been stolen or whatever. It's not a legitimate purchase. They put on a stop notice to prevent the sale from happening. And eventually all that, I guess, did fall apart to the point that in, I believe, September or October of last year, Jagex went up for auction. Pluto-sama says they were the only ones who bid on it, bidding 55% of its value. But the sale was not closed because of a certain person who was also involved in Platinum Fortune, filed all sorts of different stuff to prevent that from going through. And eventually he got to Carlyle Group and made the purchase through them with, again, this stolen money from wherever in China. So that's the gist of their allegations. There's like a 40-page document that I can't get into all of it, but yeah, basically Pluto-sama believes that they did, as you said, purchase over half of the interest in Jagex and that the current sale is invalid because it uses stolen money.
Like sands through the hourglass.
Which it should be noted, this is the best part, so to speak. The guy who got the stolen money got it from someone who now has a death sentence, a literal death sentence in China. Like he has literally been sentenced to death. So, yeah, it's all sorts of whatever the hell. Well, the guy actually, not the death sentence, but the guy who's trying to screw with the money, he has also been banned from China. He has been kicked out. He cannot go back. So, and he is Chinese. So, make of that what you will.
The allegations also include Jagex executive leadership being basically bought off or bribed with millions of dollars for the original sale to Platinum Fortune. Now that money was paid out and there was more money expected to be paid out after the sale closed. And while it's not uncommon for executives to be paid out bonuses when a company sells, those normally happen, after the company sells and the sale is closed and funded and it's all done. In this case, there was money allegedly by Pluto-sama. They are alleging that money was paid to executives in advance to just kind of shut up about the fact that Platinum Fortune did not have the money to make this initial purchase and that there was more to be coming out after. Now, we're gonna watch this because we've continued to watch this. You can search all of the sordid saga for the last 8 months on MMOBomb.com. Pluto-sama's filed this complaint on Monday of this week, so we still have a little time before anything's going to happen. And they still maintain to this day, Troy, that auction they won for one person's shares of Jagex, which was 55% of the available shares, that makes them the sole bidding on that auction, makes them the ones that own the bulk of the company. So we'll have to see where it goes from here.
Congratulations. What a mess. Oh, my God.
I mean, congratulations. RuneScape and Jagex are, you know, big money. So if you own it, that's good. But
Yeah.
One thing I wonder about now, though, is if this is, you know, if they succeed in all this, they've accused top leadership of basically taking bribes. So what is that going to do to the top leadership if they now – are they going to still want to work for Plutosama if that comes out to work like that?
Yep. Yeah. Hmm. I think there'll be leadership changes.
Yeah, you think?
Probably be leadership changes. Rolling on to some bad news. Well, I guess it's bad news if you are – you know, part of the few that play these games anymore. Lord of the Rings Online keeps managing to just piss everybody off. And it just stuns me how a game this old continually is able to just piss off its player base. So they're tweaking legendary items again. I mean, this is something they've tweaked a bunch of times. And guess what? Players aren't happy again. Jason, I know you're not extremely into Lotro anymore, but you did mention that, yeah, this, legendary items have been a point of contention for a while, and they just can't seem to get it right, and it's probably intentional.
They've gone on for years now, but we're going to completely revise the system, maybe, and they've even said, like, in the last year or so, we're going to tear it out, we're going to get rid of it, and they're going to replace it. And sure, the pandemic messed with that timeline maybe a little bit, so they haven't gotten as far along in doing that as they would have liked. But yeah, it is such a convoluted mess, that whole system. And they just keep, every time you do a tweak, every time you adjust something some way, you're going to wind up screwing something over another way. It's like, it's inevitable at this point. And they apparently did make it so that they adjusted level requirements for scrolls of empowerment. And I said, if it was 10 years ago, I know exactly what that's about, how interesting it is. But it seems like it made it to undo changes that were done in the previous patch that screwed people over. And now they're mess with this as well. It's just,
I mean, it's all basically, and this is,
you can't get it right.
You fans,
there's just so much there.
Yeah, fans have been clamoring for changes to this because they feel it's one of the features in Lotro that just heavily pushes you directly to the cash shop. The process is such a grind, and made more so by a recent patch, which is the changes they partially rolled back some of those changes in this week's patch. But yeah, they're too. Fans saying, Troy, that they're the greedy company trying to squeeze every dollar it can type narratives going around.
That was my description of it.
Yeah. As one poster put it, the goal is to keep the process of leveling a legendary item as painful as they can possibly get away with, because if there is no pain involved, nobody will bypass it via the store. Troy, I think this game is just DOA when Athlon and Amazon's game comes out. Like, even if their game is just a mediocre MMO, I think Lotro is DOA at that point.
Yeah, I think it's sad to see, like, a lot of these games that used to sit on the pedestal of free to play, right? Especially like Lotro was like one of the gold standards of free to play for a long time, and the company has such goodwill built up, and even those of us who only casually jumped in and out to see what it was about had respect for the game and the developers and the players who loved it. And you see so many of those games that used to be that way now, they're all we're gonna get to that. they're all making these and these changes that are not good, that are killing their own game that was already dying to begin with just due to dated systems or whatever. And then you go and you look at this game. It's just like, it's been promising these grand sweeping changes for years now. And as someone who's jumped into the game here and there, I've been waiting for like, oh, when are these big changes? They keep saying these big changes are coming and we're going to update this and update that. And nothing ever big really happens. And then you hear stories like this and you're like, oh, Amazon, who has failed me so many times, bring me something good.
Jason and I keep meeting, like, I keep poking him and be like, come on, we'll go do this. I'll catch these on sale, but they're fucking never on sale. And like, I go and look and it's like, wow, I would need $90 to get the up to date with the expansions. How are these not like $5 now?
Yes.
How are these not like $5 and $6 and I can get them all for $20 anymore? Like, I just don't understand it. On another note, Battleborn is officially shut down. We talked about this late last year on the free to play cast, but if you were looking for the Overwatch competitor, which it really was never an Overwatch competitor. It wasn't built for that. It wasn't made for that. But a lot of people compared it that way. I do remember watching a Total Biscuit video back in the day when both Overwatch and Battleborn were launching. And he was one of like the big ones that I saw saying, stop comparing these two games. They just don't. They're not competitors. They're not competitors. They're totally different things. But it is now totally shut down. Earlier this week, the servers went offline for the final time. It cracked, according to Jason, because you knew Jason was going to hit Steam charts, right? You knew he was going to. It cracked 100 concurrent players mark just twice in the last 3 years. And even before the shutdown notice was issued, was barely averaging more than a dozen concurrents at any given time. So I don't think too many of you are going to be upset, but maybe one or two of you watching will, you know, mathematically may be upset. That it's,
I played it for the first look, but then I was like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah, I did too. I didn't play it for the first look. I think I got it on Xbox, the Xbox One, actually, way back in the day.
But there was just too much other stuff coming out. I mean,
it came out of a horrible window.
It was in the same genre. There was so much coming out during that same time. And you just, like, as a player, you just ended up picking one.
Yep.
And that was not the one that most people pick.
Yep.
Wasn't even second place. Which is sad knowing what second place was.
We had Gigantic around that time, too, Jason. That was another one that was kind of lumped into this hero shooter. Yeah. And that was just a whole mess for 9 million other reasons. It's starting buy to play. Heard it, Guardian. You're absolutely right. I think Battleborn probably should have been free to play off the bat with the model. But they were going so towards like the PvE section of stuff too that it kind of makes it a little more challenging to monetize if you don't have a box fee. So yeah, I don't know. War, you know, that thing that never changes. Well, apparently, unless you're in World of Warships, because a lot of shit changes when you're in World of Warships. Jason, before we get to the carriers, which launched this week, a couple weeks ago, leaders got changes, and we mentioned it on the Free-to-Play cast. You weren't on that show. I know you had an opinion about that one. There were some people, some fans pissed off that this kind of skewed things a little more towards the premium players, or made the premium weaker than they rightfully felt because of how much they had spent or achieved in the game. Now that the leaders have like individual trees and talents inside individual ships, how has that changed the game? Do you like the change? What are some of the feedback now a few weeks later? I did want to circle back now that you were on here and give you a chance to comment on this.
Commanders, man.
Commanders.
But yeah, I mean, what they did is, like I said, used to be that you had a commander and you might have to specialize him for like a battleship, for instance. So you'd have all the battleship useful skills, you have a little skill tree or whatever. Now they made it so that you can have basically three different branches. Like you can have him, you can have this guy's skill sets for battleships, you can have skill sets for destroyers, for aircraft carriers, whatever. And if you want to change from one to the other, you just kind of swap over to that little tree. It used to be you'd have to like do a sort of expensive reassignment and take time to have him be crappy at the new kind of ship to learn that, whatever. So it's sort of like if you have a tank player in a MMO, if you want him to suddenly do DPS, if it's a good modern game, you just kind of click a button and you switch to his DPS build and you go for it. But this didn't have that until just recently. Now, the issue is that in doing so, they also kind of changed up the experience point requirements for everything, added a couple more levels, more points you can get, and so on. And that apparently made them a little more weaker because of the translation over. And also apparently they changed some skills around. So because I guess when they were like one size catch all, like if you pick the skill that had to apply to all the ships, they changed it now so that you can have different skills for the different kinds of ships. But that made them weaker and fans didn't like them that much. I haven't heard about any new changes to the system since then. Admittedly, I have to admit when it comes to things of this level of kind of a small scale kind of tweaky thing. Wargaming is not great about, you know, massively changing things around, saying, oh, we screwed up, we're gonna, you know, up the bonus to 15% from 10% or whatever. That sort of thing might come along, but probably not in a 2 week kind of span. So I think it's sort of thing that fans maybe were really mad about at first, but are sort of like, they're still grumbling about it, but not like, you know, delete the game from my account or from my computer or whatever, that right. Kind of mad. But I don't know if that's gonna really change in the very near future.
Well, now we have carriers.
In the console game, they've added carriers, the fourth kind of fourth category of ship to the console game. That's a pretty big deal because those were in the game, the PC game right from the start. Now they underwent a major revamp about a year and a half ago, I think. And I think they said that they wanted to get through that, make sure that was taken care of in the PC game before they added them to console. So I guess that's been put at a good enough spot. They went ahead and finally added them to the console version.
Troy, are you into like World of Tanks, World of Warships, World of Warplanes, War Thunders, you know, any of the stuff, regardless of whether it's Wargaming or themselves or other people?
No, I've tried them. I understand why people like them, but especially World of Warships, when it was first announced, I was actually kind of excited. I was like, this sounds cool. And then I got into it, and it was just like, it's not like sim realistic, but they go for more realism, and everything was just kind of slow paced. I was just like, oh, this isn't for me, but I can see where people like this. I'm not going to hate on it, but it just wasn't my thing.
In surprising news, Jason will be writing it up. I actually don't know if you already wrote it up or not for today. World of Tanks will be headed to Steam, which is kind of weird, given that just a few weeks ago, you and I were laughing about, you know, Wargaming leadership not being exactly fans of Valve and have said some things publicly in the past about that. But apparently fences have been mended when it comes to cash dollars.
What even is weirder to me, they've had World of Tanks Blitz. They had their mobile version on Steam for years now, but now they're just adding the base game to Steam. So I don't. All right. Don't know why that didn't go first, but
I don't know. But yeah, so if you want to play some warships and get your carriers on the consoles, you can. And I just, like I said, Jason, wanted to give you a chance to chime in on the commanders, because I knew when I assigned that, he wrote back, "Oh, it's a shame I'm not on the cast this week. I'd have some opinions on this one." So now you got your opinions in. Before we head over and do the weekly bombs, we put up a first look video yesterday for Chroma, Bloom and Blight. This is a free-to-play CCG available on Steam, launched end of January, towards, I think, like January 28th, something like that. Going a little bit different with the free-to-play model on this one. You're not going to buy cards. A single card, Troy. Not a single one, brother. You're not buying packs. You're not buying cards. You're not doing any of that stuff. All the heroes, all the cards are available for you right now. How they're going to do future sets, I don't know. We'll see. Like, maybe it'll be a $10 DLC. Maybe they'll just throw those in for free. I guess it all depends on how the actual monetization ends up faring for them, because the only thing you pay for in Chroma is cosmetics, whether they be loading screens, card backs, alternate art for cards, things like that. The actual cards themselves and the heroes, of which there are a plethora of heroes to choose from, are all free. As soon as you log in, you have access to all of them. Now, it is very Hearthstone inspired. I couldn't go any further without saying that. But the game does have its own unique spin on some things. The way it's broken up into three acts and everything's referencing the lore, which there's a lore tab in there for junkies that want to get into that. There's some uniqueness here. I really did like deck building. We'll talk about that in just a second here. But I wanted to get your two impressions. Troy, we'll start with you. I know you're not huge into Hearthstone or anything like that, but how about a CCG that says, nah, fuck it, you ain't buying cards?
You know, I looked at the page of the first look, and I was going to watch the video yesterday, actually. And all I saw was CCG, and I'm not going to lie, I just X'd back out. And I figured when we got to this point today that you would say, what are you thinking? I've been like, what do you think I think? It said CCG. I'm going to take a nap during this segment. But no buying cards. Like, I own all the cards, and I can just deck build and just play.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. The only monetization here is all cosmetic. There is a battle pass, too, but again, all the rewards in it are cosmetic. Again, card backs, loading screens, alternate art for a card if you want that. Some of it's actually really funky with, like, just here's a stick figure drawing of what we were planning this card to be in the development stage, but you could buy that stick figure art as the art for the cards. Yeah, and it does work on the whole, you know, getting one mana per turn system. We're all familiar with that from the popularity of Hearthstone. However, there are some unique comeback mechanics if you're a little bit behind going into Act 2 or Act 3 of a game, whether you've moved acts by time based on how many actions have taken place or somebody's been damaged enough to force the transition to the next act. Your heroes get different abilities added to them when you hit Act 2 and Act 3 of a game. Act 3 unlocks an ultimate ability that's a once-per-game use. Again, kind of a comeback mechanic. Now, I've only played about half a dozen games, and I will say that while I like the comeback mechanics in there, it's not overpowered, at least in my very limited experience right now, to the point where if Jason is well ahead of me and just pummeling me, he's not going to lose because I triggered my comeback mechanic in most situations. But if we're having a pretty good match and I'm down a little bit, I could use them to rebound. Deck building is pretty unique in the respect that your hero determines the color manas you're going to play with out of the four available. Each hero will say, like, let's say 2 purple and 10 red is that hero's color. So you could, if you really like that hero and those abilities, you could just say, all right, I want that hero, so now I'm going to go build a red, purple, and neutral card deck. Or you could do it in reverse and say, I like the mechanics of the red and the purple cards. Let me find a hero that supplements that deck. So you can go both ways in it. The neat thing that I really like, Jason, and maybe you've seen this other places, I had not, so I'll defer to you and your CCG broad span of knowledge, was if your hero has like 2 red and 8 purple mana, you can actually assign what order you're going to get those mana in. So turn 1, your first mana will be red 1. Turn 2 and 3, you'll have a purple. And turn 4, you'll have red. So you can tailor the colors of mana coming out to the deck that you may have built that's going to require, let's say, a lot of red early, but then a lot of purple later. So there is some strategy there in how you're actually even going to gain your resources, which I thought was a really interesting touch to deck building.
Yeah, I thought that was a pretty cool aspect of it. And it's like you said, too, you know, it has it's you know, got a base that's kind of like Hearthstone or Magic, but then it does a few little things different. And
yeah,
that's like every CCG.
Yeah.
Pretty much every CCG does that thing. We're just like Hearthstone or just like Magic. And here are like the 4 things that we do a little differently. And admittedly, for the most part, for this game, I thought the things they did differently were actually pretty cool and not just kind of a tacked on thing that was like, oh, we're doing this just to be different. The only thing I didn't really like, I think, was the whole guard attack mode. That kind of bugged me. Maybe because it has kind of a Yu-Gi-Oh feel to it. I don't know. But
yeah, that's where you can set characters to be in guard mode and then they can't attack or be attacked. Now they could still be nuked with a spell or something like that, but they can't be attacked.
Yeah, and I get that because a lot of times when you play Hearthstone, you're like, I have this cool card I want to play, this creature. But if I do that, the other guy on his next turn is going to immediately attack it and kill it, so I'm not going to get anything out of it. So I understand having that exist for 1 turn, so you at least get the guy out and have to do a little something special with him. I don't like that you can hide him there like the whole game, basically, if you want to. Even though you have this advantage of not being able to attack, but even so, I imagine there are cards that are good that just have a passive effect that are like, hey, get this out, and it does a thing for a while. Although, again, with the way they did enchantments, with stuff only lasting for a limited time, that's kind of a neat thing, too. But yeah.
There's a few things. Then there's plating, and then there's structures. I mean, there's all kinds of different things in the decks. Again, it's one that you've got to mess with. I will say on the downside, it is an indie title, small team type deal, so the art style may not be your cup of tea. Or there might be some slight performance issues as, you know, bugs are worked out and more people play it. I think that stuff's to be expected. The one thing that I do think it was really lacking, totally initially, was a tutorial. Now, a day or two ago, they put in a basic tutorial, Troy, to get you through just playing an actual game. But it by no means goes into, like, there's nothing in the game that teaches you what I just taught you about deck building and how you could take a hero and build a deck around that, or build a deck and then grab an appropriate hero that complements it, and how you can order your mana and stuff like that. So there is still a lot that I think needs to go into the game, but it was very interesting. And I'm sorry, like, somebody commented that the first look was boring. It was 20 minutes on a card game. I, you know, sometimes there's
What are they looking for?
Sometimes they were like, yeah, it needs to be more modern and cut jokes and do flash cuts and stuff like that. And I'm like, well, it really depends on the game. I mean, it's a card game. I hear the feedback. Go check out the V4 first look. Go check out the Estelia first look. You know, I do stuff like that, but, you know, it's a card game. I can only do so much with that. I showed one game, and then I showed deck building. It took 20 minutes. There we go. That is another thing, too, Troy, that I don't know it's going to be a pro or a con for some people. The games do tend to be a little bit long when compared to things like Hearthstone and stuff like that.
Yeah, to me, like you say that, and that's automatically a turn off again. If I was going to play a game like that, I would want something where it's more in and out. And they're quick. If it's going to be longer than Hearthstone, no, I'm not interested. Thanks.
See, that kind of interests me because there's a little more strategy that goes into it. But again, that is definitely a flavor of the player there. I'm going to give this one a thumbs up. It stayed installed. And it's one, Jason, even if I wasn't interested in, I think, as for doing what we do, is one that I would watch because I want to see how that monetization fares out. Like, I really want the monetization to do well here. That way you can say, you can show, look, you don't have to be buying these fucking booster packs and all this stuff. You know, you can do this different ways. But I say that at the same time knowing I'm somebody that doesn't care about card backs and loading screens and alternate art. So literally, I would only be buying something to support the developer, not because there's anything there that I want. I would recommend that, like, if they're going to continue this model and when they expand the card bases in some ways, I would imagine that's, hey, you know, pay us $10 and you just get all the cards in the DLC type deal.
Yeah. I mean, it's a noble idea, but the reason CCGs make money and exist is because they sell the packs.
It's definitely one to watch.
That's why they go.
Yes.
If you're into CCGs, I give it a thumbs up. Definitely one worth checking out. Chroma on Steam, available now, absolutely free, and you can go ahead and build the deck you're going to run with till eternity if you want to, right off the bat. So I'm going to give it a thumbs up. Troy, I'm assuming you're a thumbs down, just because it's a CCG, and that's not you.
I'm sideways just because I don't care. Like, it's a CCG.
What do you got, Jason?
If I wanted to play another CCG, I would give it a thumbs up, but I really will never probably want to do another one again.
Let's slide over and do the weekly bombs. Mr. Blackburn, why don't you go first, sir?
Oh, Lord have mercy. Dear game ago, battle passes do not belong in MMOs.
Oh, boy.
Rift used to be one of my favorite games ever. I legitimately quit World of Warcraft for Rift and stuck with Rift for so long. That was such a good game. And if you missed it last week, on Thursdays, I stream from 2 to 4 Eastern. And we jump back into Rift for nostalgia reasons. And I was having a good time. I got all the way through the starter zone into the main world. We're running around. We're talking about how good the base game still is. And, like, there's dated systems, but still so much fun and how much nostalgia we have for the game. And this little glowy thing catches my attention on the screen. So I click it. Battle Pass. What is this? Why is there a Battle Pass in this MMO? Not only is there a Battle Pass in an MMO, it is... You have to pay for it on top of being a patron, the monthly subscription, in order to get some of the shittiest rewards I have ever seen. They give you packs of artifacts. If you know Rift, you know what artifacts, the little Easter egg hunt. Not only that, but they've created new sets that you have to collect for this battle pass. It is the most depressing thing. Go back and watch the end of the stream from last week. It made me quit. I cut the stream off. I was done at that point. A-bomb to battle passes in MMOs. What the fuck?
Jason, go ahead.
Okay, it's my turn.
Yeah. Sorry, we jumped back in there.
All I'm going to do something that I never thought I would do. Like 15 years ago, I had a terrible experience with Netflix to the point that I made this giant rant on my live journal, to show you how long ago it was, about how awful it was and how much I hated it. And I said I would never, I never buy Netflix again.
Okay.
And I still haven't, but the people I live with have it, so I've been using their account lately. And I've actually been I've been overusing it for the past several months. Yeah, you know, and pandemic, whatever, this, that, sitting at home, finding stuff to watch. So I have to give a da bomb to Netflix for the fact that I've been using it so much lately. Currently, I'm watching Cobra Kai, going through that. Last month, I watched The Queen's Gambit and Erased, which is a pretty good anime series. So that and a lot of other things I've been watching over the past several months. Watched Avatar and Korra a couple months ago. I'm trying to get into that. So, yeah. Da bomb to Netflix, I guess.
I'm going to give a dub bomb to Valorant's tweaking of competitive. We talked about Apex Legends at the beginning and their Season 8. Valorant making changes to its competitive thing. And although I'm not a huge fan of like the game myself all that much, I got to give credit where due. You know, Riot's had some bad news for a while now, so a little credit where due. To me, watching the development, it seems like Riot has been all over making this game an esports success, but like in all the right ways, not like this is going to be the next big esport. It's just, they're just focused on doing their thing. So I'm going to give them a dub bomb. From the viewers, Ninja Panda is giving a dub bomb to my PC for finally returning home. Thanks to UPS. Now just need to set it up once my room's been sorted out. And a question for Jason. What are your thoughts on the new Starship Troopers Terran Command RTS game? If you've heard of it, there is a Steam page.
I have not heard of it, and I saw the movie Starship Troopers, whatever, 20 years ago, and haven't really thought much of it since. So,
Old Glory and A-bomb to Twitch buffering so much today. I don't know what's up with Twitch. Sorry. Jace, A-bomb to Twitch. Seriously, why? Windshark giving an A-bomb to Twitch for lack of streams this week. Oh, to us, to our channel. I'm used to more streams per week from you guys, and you disappointed this week. We did. Yeah, I streamed on Monday. Jason had stuff Wednesday, so he couldn't stream. And then Troy he got tied up yesterday. So, yeah, it'll be back to normal next week. I'll be Monday. Troy will be Thursday. I'll be Friday. And if Jason's available, he'll pop on Wednesday.
I might be.
Guardian Veil, A-bomb to work. Haven't played a game all week. That sucks to Twitch. Way too much buffering today. Well, we'll be on YouTube. You'll have the recording on YouTube. You can see Troy's rant if you missed any of it there. From other viewers, Sokapek says, well, this is strange. I actually had a job interview with Simon talking about last week and Scavenger Studios story. Had an interview with Simon a long time ago when he was the lead at Spearhead Games. He was, in fact, a bit of a dick during the interview. If the allegations are true, I hope he gets help and improves himself. It's a shame. Go ahead, Jason.
From Alcyon Game Crazy, the only reason I don't own an Xbox is that I am being forced to pay for gold to play free-to-play games. But now the only reason I don't own an Xbox is because I already own a gaming rig.
Yeah, so too little too late on that removal.
Yeah, you missed your chance there, Xbox.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. C-Swag says, da-bomb to the game Valheim on Steam. It's early access and $20, but there's no buy and pie fly to do. What? No buys and pie fly to do? Lots of fun and super relaxing. I have no idea what that sentence means.
I've been watching people play Valheim on streams a lot lately, and they're really getting into it, so looks pretty good.
Troy, finish off the viewer bombs there.
Tycal 2399, dub bomb to EA for bringing back college football. FIU about to be 15-time national champion.
Yeah, it is interesting that they're getting back in, and now won't have the NCAA title. That's definitely changed. So, but we'll see. We'll see how that is. And actually, yeah, Tamina says you won't be here next Friday. That's right. No cast next Friday, and no stream from myself next Friday.
Yeah, it's true.
I'll be out Thursday and Friday of next week. So I will stream Monday. We'll set the stream up, Troy, for you so that you can get your stream on Thursday and get everything set up there.
Just be aware, if the stream underneath me says something else, just know that I'm playing whatever I want.
No. It won't. If you tell me Wednesday night what you're playing, if Jason streams Wednesday, I'll set it up for him when he's done. If you tell me Wednesday night what you're going to play Thursday, I'll set it up and Jason can tweet out for you.
Good.
So we'll be all good on that front. But yeah, so no free-to-play cast next Friday. We'll be back the following Friday. Question of the week last week. We're about 2 months now from open beta. How interested are you in Magic Legends now? What are you liking? What are you not liking? And just in case you needed to throw some money at it, yeah, the monetization has already started. Planeswalker bundle available for the game, $40. Value of $80, I'm sure. Dragon Master Lex, making it an ARPG kills it almost instantly. The only thing that generates interest would be the Magic name brand, and that can't hold it long. Diablo, Path of Exile, even Vindictus with its hub-style mission-run games die off quickly. People just aren't interested in old-school 2.5D scrollers anymore. They want immersion and interaction. And you can't get that from returning to a hub every 20 minutes. Even games like The Old Republic, which is an MMO, suffers a bit from this because once you complete the storyline, you get bored of running flashpoints all day. The missions will not change, and it will begin to feel like a grinding game, and that's what killed games like Terra. You hit the wall of progression that made you grind the exact same thing for months and months, which removed the fun from the game. This style worked when you added mission-type dungeon runs to a game, but had the game itself be open world so you can roam and do things and explore without reasons finding new areas and random things to do. That's like most MMOs now.
Wait, did this guy say Diablo and Path of Exile died off quickly?
That's how I read it. I was just under wondering.
I'm like, wait a second.
I had examples chosen.
And even Terra was, pretty popular for like a good 5 years or so before it started really getting shit on, so
Windshark, just to make a free-to-play cast without Mike, we got enough hosts, would be something fresh. You certainly can. There's tech aspects and consideration that go into that I think prohibit that, but
and I'm lazy.
There you go. Go ahead, Jason, take the next one.
Jared Nelson says LOL 5. I don't know LOL 5. I am picking for each color of Magic the Gathering, and that I heard it will come to console, so not too excited to play on PC, that I would rather wait for console and still wondering what is coming into the game for more classes or whatnot. Jared,
you're getting one class per color, and it will be on consoles. I don't know if it's going to be a simultaneous launch, but they just keep saying consoles and PC later this year. Finish. Troy.
Ditzy asked the question, so Magic Legends is just a polished version of Cardslinger?
All right, so I actually had to look this one up. I was not aware of what the hell Cardslinger was. It's nothing I had ever heard of. But the answer is yes. Jason, I don't know if you saw this. So Joshua Christensen, I believe, is the name. And this is like very alpha build-ish video of it. But this is an ARPG with a card-based system that determines your abilities that you can use while you're fighting things, evading traps and stuff like that. So the answer, surprisingly, is yeah. Yeah, it kind of is.
It does kind of look similar, yeah.
And I had to look it up. I had never heard of it. Cardslinger, Joshua Christensen, if you want to Google it. This is a early build demo reel, sizzle reel video type thing. But yeah, the abilities change based on cards and see how they're disappearing and then reappearing in different combinations because they're using the abilities and drawing cards. So yeah, it is. It's been done before.
Maybe he could sue.
maybe.
I know.
Yeah, there you go. Random guy, two Wizards of the Coast.
Right.
Go for it.
Perfect. good luck with that lawsuit. I think Wizards of the Coast does more suing than being sued.
We had that trademark that we had to deal with back in '96.
The question of the week this week, and again, no show next week, so you have 2 weeks to answer it, 2 weeks to get your weekly bombs in there. There better be a shit ton on YouTube and on MMO Bomb when we come back for the next show. I want to know your thoughts on Chroma, Bloom, and Blight. Does it do enough to separate itself from the CCGs? Does it do enough monetization-wise that it would be able to support itself without selling packs? So even if you're not like into this specific game itself, it's not something you'll play, I want to know if you think that model could work in the CCG space. Because, Jason, I don't know about you, but I seriously have my doubts when your card game doesn't include any card monetization.
I think if you're a team of like three people, maybe it can, but you're never going to expand beyond that.
We'll see. We'll see. Let us know what you think in the comments below. Don't forget your weekly bombs. Dub bomb for something good, A bomb for something bad in the world of gaming or just life in general. Until the next show, Troy, where can everybody find you, my friend?
Hey, yo, right here, twitch.tv/MMOBomb. Next Thursday, 2 p.m. Eastern time, we're going to stream some games and have some fun and try not to quit in pure depression again.
Mr. Winter.
On Twitter, I'm Winter Informal, streaming at twitch.tv/JasonWinter.
I'm Mike Byrne. You can follow me personally there at MagicMan1, but more importantly, follow at MMOBomb. Get tweets with all the latest news, articles, first look videos, free-to-play casts, free-to-play weekly giveaways, and so much more. Stay safe. We'll see you on the servers.